We'll start the show now. We'll start off with Tehillim. I was just given the names of several people. Apparently, there's a building in Miami which collapsed, and there's several Yidden who are unaccounted for. So I have a name: Chaim ben Sora, Malko bas Sora Rochel, Yisrael Tzvi Yosef ben Toiba, Tzvi Doniel ben Yehudis. So I'll say Kapitel Chof and Kuf Nun. Lam Natsiach Mizbel David, Ya Ancho Adonai B'yom Tzara, Yisagev Choshem Elohe Yaakov, Yishlach Ezra Kami Kodesh, Umitzira Yisadecho, Yisker Kol Min Chisecho, Vailasecho Yudash Naselo, Yiten Lecho Chilo Vavecho, Vuchol Atos Chayimale, Nerana Nabishu Asecho, Shem Elohe Nidgel, Yimale Adonai Kol Mishal Yisecho. Ati yodati ki hoshia adinoi meshichoi aneu mishmei kodshoi bigburis yeshi yiminoi eile vorechev veile vasusim vanachnu v'shem adinoi lehinu nazkir heim okoru v'nafolu vanachnu kamnu v'nis aydod adinoi hishio hamelach yaneinu v'yim koreinu and kapitel kufnun halalu yo halalu eile kodshoi halalu v'kia uzei halalu bigburisov halalu v'krev gudloi halalu v'segashofa halalu v'nevo v'chiner Hallelujah, Sefer Mochel, Hallelujah, Bemini Ve'ugav, Hallelujah, Betzilts Leshoma, Hallelujah, Betzilts Lesrua, Kreil Hanashoma, Hallelujah, Hallelujah. Here, Besuras Tevis. Dedicated today's Shia to Bichos and Carla, who got married just an hour and a half ago, 2 hours ago. Shnei Zalman Kesselman, Reb Eliezer, and Chaim Mushka Potash. Daughter of the late Reb Shimon Potash, is still within the Yud Beis Chodesh, and we wish them a vice name of Yisrael, Binyan Adi Ad V'Dor Yashar Mivorach. Let's start our shiur. Okay, so the story, which I've changed the details just to cover up for privacy, but let's say there's a Chabad Shliach who's been doing a Lag Baomer event for several years, and there's a certain Reb Meir who's been contributing towards the costs, and he was given the privilege of lighting the fire of the Lag Baomer. Gracious. Okay. Years have gone on, and now the organization needs to have much more money, and they realized that this Lag Baomer celebration can generate more income, because if Reb Meir was ready to give $5,000, Reb Shneur is ready to give Shneur. It's $10,000. Yeah, you know, the name Shneur comes from it's mentioned in Poskim. There was a family, there were two Zaydas, one was called Yoyer and one was called Meir. And so they didn't know which name to give, so they gave the name Shneur. Shneur. That's the way it's brought in Hichas Gittin, by Shemes Gittin. Although the name Shneur may actually come from the word of Senor. But let's come back and keep to our point. So now the question here is, have Reb Meir, who's been doing this mitzvah of lighting, or this privilege of lighting the menorah, and the bonfire for Lag Baomer for so many years, does he have the rights of a chazaka? And therefore the question, does the Moisud have the rights to now give this privilege to someone else who will give more money? So this is the question. Is there a chazaka over here? So now we have, and here we have a piece from the Shulchan Aruch. Now this comes up is Shulchan Aruch in two places, in Cheshen Mishpat and in Hilchos Beis HaKnesses in Erech Chaim. But the piece which you have in front of you, to the left of your page, is from Cheshen Mishpat. Yochid sheyesh lo sefer Torah, behechzik shehatzibur koyre tom le besefer Torah sheloi. So there's a yochid, an individual who owns a sefer Torah, and he's had the privilege that his sefer Torah is used on a regular basis. Im hoyol tzibur sefer Torah acheres, shekasher akar b'sheloi, if the Tzibur did have another Sefer Torah, and yet they kept using his Sefer Torah, so then Chazaka, Mikri Chazaka, then he can claim a Chazaka. It's my Sefer Torah is being used, Vasurim Lashanos, and they're not allowed to now suddenly switch to use another Sefer Torah. If they didn't have another Sefer Torah, so you can't claim Chazaka for the simple reason that, there was by default there was no other Sefer Torah, so you can't claim that this was chosen. But when there's another Sefer Torah and still they chose to use this Sefer Torah, so then there is an element of Chazaka here, and they wouldn't be allowed to switch to someone else's Sefer Torah without the first owner's permission. So that's the Ramon in Simon Kuf Mem Test in Choshen Mishpat. Now, on the margin, we have the Pischei Tshuva, that's the lower left, the lower right, who quotes from the Sefer Shar Mishpat, who quotes from the Sefer Chassidim, that there was a story there, that there was a Chochom who had the custom. For many years, he would give a specific amount of tzedakah, and he would have the privilege of the lighting the candles in the shul. And then he writes, this Chochom says, now there's a bunch of young guys, not such respectable people. In the middle of Shir now, it's called me after nine. So there's a bunch of people who are not such worthy people. And they decided they're going to outbid him. If he had been giving 500, then again, they're going to give 1,000, 1,200. Then that group of people, each one will give a few hundred pounds, whatever, golden, and they would outbid him. And so he was asking, what should he do? Should he go along with it, or should he insist on his privilege? And the answer, which is written in Sefer Hasidim, is, even though they don't mean Hashem Shammayim, they should be allowed to buy this privilege and to outbid him. So in other words, he doesn't have a chazaka. They should, if they're offering more money for tzedakah, the thing is that the tzedakah should get more money. And so even though it may not be for sincere motives, that he should allow them to outbid him. In other words, to accept the fact that they outbid him and go along with it, not insist on chazaka. So if that's the case, now this is the Shar Mishpat is suggesting, if there's a chazaka, by you did pay money and someone can outbid you, how much more so if you have a chazaka which you didn't pay money for? That's what his theory is. Let's now go to the upper quote here on your right, which is from the Mishnah Brura in Bir Halacha, and he quotes the Shah Mishpat, and at the end he says, Ochim b'tshuvas radvaz, so the tshuva of Radvaz was one of the later Rishonim, and his story was about a woman, a widow, and she had claimed a chazaka that she would light the candles in a particular point in the shul. It was the candles in front of the Aron Kodesh. And she says her late husband was the one who built the Aron Kodesh. And she has a chazaka. Now the community decided they're ready to sell this privilege to someone else to be able to have the privilege of lighting these candles. And Al-Khayra, she didn't pay anything. She's just been lighting these candles for all these years. Not she's paid for the privilege. It's just she's been doing it all these years. And the Radvaz actually rules in her favor. So here we've got a little bit of a contradiction. Here we're saying from the Sefer Chassidim that one who's paid for a privilege, a mitzvah privilege, can be outbidded. And the Radvaz is saying that no, that the person who didn't, even they didn't pay, cannot be bought out. And actually, I don't see it as such a contradiction. On the contrary, when the person, this widow, no one was bothered about it. She volunteered and she did it. And now you realize, oh, we can make some money out of this. You want to push her out. That chazaka, she has a chazaka. That's what Radvazes say. And the Sefer Hasidim is talking about when the person had the privilege because he paid money. Now, not to be distracted by the story in the Shulchan Aruch with the Sefer Torah. I allowed you to use my Sefer Torah. So why can't we switch to another Sefer Torah? There it's out of respect for the Sefer Torah, not so much because of the owner. He allowed you to use the Sefer Torah, but there's a respect for the Sefer Torah, therefore you shouldn't switch to another one without good reason. Coming back. So then, what we're seeing here is, when Reuven had paid, or in this case, when Reb Meir had been paying 5,000 for a privilege, and comes along Reb Shneir is ready to pay 10,000, then that's legitimate. And that's what the Sefer Chassidim is saying, and Radvaz just doesn't disagree. Radvaz is talking about when the first one had been doing it totally voluntarily, without paying for it. It's a little bit counterintuitive, but there is a certain logic here. This is a chazaka which is kind of defined by money. And therefore, if it's defined by money, then more money would outbid it. The other one is a chazaka by mere devotion, not with money. And therefore, it's going to be harder to push that one away. Now, at any rate, I felt that in this case, for sure, that we have the Sefer Chassidim, who says that you can outbid, and Reb Shneir should be given the privilege. And of course, Reb Meir has the can still offer to match what Reb Shneir is offering. But if he doesn't, so then it should go to the higher offer. Let's go on to our next question. So we have here a question about im chuppah. No, just made a chuppah for Hashem, and someone asks a question. In the local park, there's a beautiful gazebo, a musical grandstand, and they're asking, could they use this gazebo as a chuppah? Let's say it does have openings on all four sides. It's actually hexagonal. Is there an issue, dafka? So there's a couple of questions here. Does the chuppah have to have dafka four poles? Does it have to be open on all sides? Does it have to be a cloth cover? So actually, the word chuppah is very, very significant in halacha, because the chuppah makes the difference for a woman who's just arusa, just betrothed, to become nesua, to become fully married. So the chuppah is the symbolic transition, symbolic of the transition of just being committed to get married, to actually moving in and marrying and living keder kol ha'aretz. What exactly the nature of a chuppah is? What is it? So there's a discussion in the various opinions. So here we have, this is from Shulchan Aruch Avinu Ezer, Siman Nun Hei, and he says chuppah. The second line says chuppah is synonymous with nisuin. Now, then in the Rashi writing, some say chuppah is the yichud. Sorry, some say the chuppah is not the yichud. Rather, it's when the chosen brings her to his home. Some say the chuppah is that they spread a cloth over the heads of the chosen kala at the time of the bracha. In other words, at the time of the sheva brachas, they throw a talus of sorts over the chosen kala. Some say the chuppah is actually that the kala goes out of her house with her hair uncovered. That's yatzabenu, with some kind of headdress. And almona, it's yichud. And then, minag poshut. Now the minag is to refer to the chuppah, mokoim shemachnisim shom yuriya prusa al gabi klinsis. It's a drape drawn over poles, and the chos and kala are brought under this drape, supported by poles, barabim in public, and that's where the kedushin is done, and the barachas of erusin and nisuin. And then they're taken indoors, and they eat in a private place, and that's the two of them together, apparently, are what makes the chuppah. All right, so we have here the tradition, and this seems to be identified lahalocha, that it, so what that could mean is, in different communities. Chuppah may have been a different procedure. All it means is this is the procedure which is identifying the transition from being merely betrothed, and this is how marriage is celebrated, and that's called chuppah. And it can take on different forms. Meanwhile, though, the form which it takes on in Ashkenaz is the yuriya prus al gabe klodesus. It's dafka, a drape spread over poles. And if you remember the loshen which Rus said to Boaz, uforasto knofecho al amosecho, may you spread your corner of your garment over your maid. So there is an expression here of taking under my garment. The husband, the chosen, is taking the kala under his wing and going to provide for her, look after her, etc. But there is this notion dafka for us to knofech al amosecho. So there seems to be that the drape yuriya prusa is not because they didn't have wood or other materials with which to make a canopy. It looks like it's dafka. It should be dafka, a cloth, and therefore the gazebo wouldn't be appropriate, in addition to the fact that it's different other things. It's not loyal to the minig Yisrael. Just to add to this, someone, I had already sent out the agenda before, so someone sent me this reference. In Minchas Yitzchok, Dain Weiss of Manchester, in his Chelik Hei Simon Lamed, he was asked about a chuppah made out of ferns, branches and flowers, and he objects to it on the very same grounds, that the chuppah has to be dafka made of a drape of cloth, and it shouldn't be made of ferns and branches. No objection to a few flowers here and there. That's not the problem. The problem is that the chuppah should be made of a cloth which is draped over sticks, over poles. Some say it should dafka, that the drapes should fall, not only be level, there should also be a little bit of a fall, so it should somehow resemble a doorway. And we've got this idea, which some associate with Avraham Avinu having a tent with four doorways. Let's not get into that though. Okay, let's go on. Right, and now someone asked the following question, just built a mikveh, and he wants to put up a plaque with the brocha so that the people who use it will be able to say the brocha, not having to rely on memory. So are you allowed to, obviously in the mikveh people are not dressed, are you allowed to stand in presence of a holy text and without being, not properly dressed? So let's read the Rash, the from the Alter Rebbe Shulchan Aruch, and this is from Simon Memhei. He says, he's talking about this idea of not being exposed in front of sacred objects. And then he says, Abel bebeis ha-tvilo, in the mikveh, even though it's in a merchatz, in a bathhouse, you wouldn't be allowed to say brocha, but the beis ha-tvilo, in a mikveh, you would be allowed to say brocha, because it's done with cold water. And therefore, it doesn't have zuhamos. The word zuhamor, I'm translating as grime. I don't have a better word. And therefore, you'd even be allowed to enter the Beis HaTevila with tefillin if there's no one naked there. And that's the reason, says the Alter Rebbe, why we can make a brocha, Birchas HaTevila, in the mikveh, even before you go down to the water, even though it's this place where people would stand there naked. And the reason he's saying is because the Beis HaTevila is cold water. It's not all steamy and therefore slimy, etc., etc. Then you would be allowed to. Now, what I've seen in Sforim is, in other Sforim, that this is true. Well, first of all, the Alter Rebbe is talking about a cold mikveh. Nowadays, our mikvehs are hot, and so the room is quite steamy. For men, this question only comes up if you wanted to toivel kalim inside a men's mikveh. So, where if a person's toveling and makes a bracha before their own tevila, Then they are actually have gone down into the mikveh. They're up to their chest or higher in the water. The fact that they are in the mikveh creates like a separate reshus, because it's got the walls around the mikveh. The mikveh itself has got like walls that separates it from the rest of the room. So arguably they could make a brocha as they are standing in the mikveh, even if it was a mikveh anoshim, inside the mikveh would be okay. But to stand in the place where above the surface, and where people tend to stand naked, even though they're not there, you wouldn't be allowed to make a brocha over there, and certainly if they are naked. Right, then we've got in the Alter Rebbe's Siddur, that's what we have at the bottom over here. He comes up with an interesting chiddush, and others point out it's a chiddush of the Alter Rebbe. If there is soya, if there's excrement, it's a contradiction to tefillah and tefillin. And also it's a contradiction for others for him. If there is excrement in a house, you wouldn't be allowed to leave sforim exposed, unless they are on a table or a shelf, 10 tefachim higher, above the floor. Within 10 tefachim, that wouldn't be okay. This is very relevant. For example, to change a baby's nappy. It shouldn't be done shouldn't be exposed in front of sforim. If you have to do it in the same room, then perhaps you do it in a way that your body is obstructing between the exposure of the tzoya or the to the sforim. So coming back, we do have a problem of a human exposing themselves in front of a holy text, in front of a brocha, and but actually with the case of this plaque, they were going to write Baruch Ato Hashem with a hey, with a stroke, and a lekenu, they would put a hyphen. And in that way, they would not really have a Shem Hashem on display. And I felt that was okay. Now, I've said that. I don't have a solid source that putting a hyphen in Hashem's name takes away its kedusha. That is what is generally accepted. We see that people do that, and in whatever it's forim or whatever in other sources. But what is exactly the halachic source that by putting a hyphen that takes away the kedushas Hashem? I don't have a solid source for that. And of course, anyone who does have a source now or later, I'll be happy to hear about it. Let's move on. Someone this week called me up about 11 o'clock or 10 o'clock in the morning for whatever personal reasons, disturbance, instability, whatever. He had forgotten to say the morning brachas. He's not living at home, he's living somewhere else. And normally at home, he'd have his say brachas and have a coffee and then go to shul. But he was not at home, so the whole thing was... So he realized he hadn't said the brachas in the morning. So does one say brachas later on in the day? And so the answer is basically yes. One would say the brachas later, with the exception of the concern is about Birchas HaTorah. Now, the brocha which we say before Shema, called Avas, starting with the words Avas Oilom or Ava Rabo, it has in it, this is from the Alter Rebbe Shulchan Aruch, you can see, has in it some words about praise of and thanks for relating to our Limud HaTorah. The same Bilibeinu Lilmud Olamed, we start the word bina. So there is a svara that having said the brocha avas oilom, you already yotze the birchas haTorah. There are those who say that's only true if right after Shmoyne Esther you had learned some Torah. But if you didn't learn Torah right after Shmoyne Esther, then the avas oilom does not count as birchas haTorah. There's a second opinion which says that you don't, that if you'd said Avas Olam, even if you didn't learn right after Shmoneh Esrei, you still Yotze Birchas HaTorah with Avas Olam. That's the second paragraph. Third paragraph says, V'yesh Lochosh L'Divrayim, and therefore he says that if you said Avas Olam, and you then you would not say Birchas HaTorah afterwards. So B'di'eved, Avas Olam, even if you didn't realize that I have to use this for Birchas HaTorah, B'di'eved, Avas Olam will count for Birchas HaTorah. And certainly the case, which happened to be, that this fellow had actually, it was a Monday, and he had been called up to the Torah. So he already said Birchas HaTorah by Aliyah LaTorah. So for sure, he had already a Birchas HaTorah. I know that in Birchas HaTorah, there are three aspects. There's the Al-Divrei Torah, which is Birchas HaMitzvahs. Then you've got Harevno, which is like a Bakosha. And then you've got Shemno Bochabonu, which is a Birchas HaTorah. Well, there are different forms, three different forms in the Birchas HaTorah. But interesting, here in Shulchan Aruch, it does not differentiate. It looks like the one broch of Avas Olam seems to cover for all the different details of Birchas HaTorah. And so, reading this now, this is not what I told the person on the morning, but reading this now, it looks like, having said Avas Olam, he should not be saying Birchas HaTorah. But the other Birchas HaShachar would apply even later in the day. Mizolnish Wissen, but if a person was an Oinon, at the time for Birchas HaShachar, then after the Levi is no longer an Oinon, he would not say Birchas HaShachar because he was exempt of the Birchas HaShachar at the time when the Chiv occurred, when he got up in the morning, and therefore, since he was exempt then, he would not say the Birchas HaShachar later. By contrast, Birchas HaTorah he would say later because that's Birchas HaMitzvahs, and so he would say after Levi, say Birchas HaTorah before going on to whatever else he has to do. Let's move on. So here is a young man who's working in a retail store. And all right, I'll tell you the detail. I think he's working as a sofer. And let's say he is given a mezuzah or something to fix up, and he messes up with it. He messed up, he spilt the ink. I don't know what. He made it in a way that he ruined it. So there was a mezuzah, let's say, which was worth $50, and he damaged it, and now the mezuzah can't be sold. And he understands that he's liable. He's asking retail price or wholesale price. This is his question. And it's interesting because it looks like it's a machlokas haposkim, a machlokas in Rambam and other rishonim. But let's take the shita of the other rishonim. There's an expression, dover hagoyim lemomoin eini momen. Something which enables money to be made is not called money. A person, this wholesaler, I mean, sorry, the shop owner bought the stuff at a wholesale price. That is his definite loss. He, by selling it, he could make profit, but that money hasn't happened yet. So he turns to the worker, he says, well, I could have sold it for $80. I bought it for 50, I could have sold it for 80. But that's a question of Dover Hagoyrim Lamomen. It's not Momen. So my impression is that he would not have to pay the retail price, which could have been generated, especially if there are other mezuzahs in stock and there can be a replenishment of stock. It's not as if he's done his employer out of a profit, because there was still other mezuzahs for sale, and so they can buy more mezuzahs at the wholesale price and sell them for the retail price. So no, he'd only have to pay, that's my impression, he'd only have to pay for the wholesale price. There's a separate discussion about, and the Gemara talks about a person who, a porter who carried a barrel and slipped and the barrel got broken, and the Chochem at the time, the owner, the employer who owned the barrel, was also one of the Amiroim, and the Rosh Hashiva told him that he should not charge the porter. Because, and then not only did he tell not to charge the porter for the damage, he told him also to pay the porter for his time. And he said the owner of the barrel was very surprised. He ruined my barrel and I should pay him wages. And he said, Leman telech b'derech toivim. Leman telech b'derech toivim. This fellow's got a family to feed. He spent, so Leman telech, under lifnim mishur sadin, not only shouldn't he charge him for the broken barrel, he should actually pay him for the time which he was employed. Let's move on. I don't know why, where this question came from, as in someone had said that he had heard that one doesn't, well, we know that of harachamim, which we say before Musaf, we don't say it on a day when Tachanun is not said. So someone had told him that when a chosn is present, that doesn't push aside saying of harachamim. I don't know where that comes from, but this is from Simon Reish Pei Dalet and Alter Rebbe Shulchan Aruch. It talks about the minig of saying of harachamim. We know that of harachamim is associated with the Crusades. This was the time when it was Dafka, this time of the year, at the time around just before Shavuos, where the Crusades massacred communities in Germany, etc., in Speyer, in Worms, in Mainz. And these are the killers, the communities which were destroyed, which are mentioned in the Av HaRachamim. And that's the reason, by the way, that Shabbos Mevorach Masivin, we do say Av HaRachamim, whereas other Shabbos Mevorachim, we don't. Because this is the time of the year when the pogroms took place, and therefore that's the original time of HaRachamim, of saying Av HaRachamim. So let's come back to our point over here. But it says clearly, every day that you don't say tzidkoscha, v'tzidkoscha, really? That's interesting how they spelt out the Rosh HaTevis. Whenever you don't say tzidkoscha, you don't say av harachamim, v'ein maskir neshamas, v'chein kishe yesh chasno emilo, on a day where, well, there's no chasno shamas, obviously, so it means where there are, where there's a chasno, there's a choson, and there's a celebration. So then that would push aside saying the Av HaRachamim. It's interesting, it may not be so well known nowadays. There was a time where they had a minig that whenever there's a chasana, instead of the regular haftorah, they would say the soy sauce. The haftorah was changed because to a theme of got to do with the celebration of a chasana. Right. Someone asks me the question that he had forgotten to daven a tefillah, and therefore he has to daven to Shimon Estres. How does it go from one to the other? Does he just, by Lekayin Atzoyer, just go back to the beginning, or does he take back three steps, etc.? So let's read that inside. Hamispalal beis tefillas zoyach hazoy, when he's davening two tefillas, one after the other, like Shachris, then Musaf, or that he had forgotten to daven, and therefore he has to compensate. Is davening a second time, a second tefillah. Sorich lahamtin bein zoy lezoy. That's the third line of the text. One should have a pause between one and the next. Kadesha tehei daitim yosheves larich dvoro veloshin tchino. You should relax, take a break, and then you're going to start again, and in a way of supplication, rather than just rattling off one after the other, which may be like chavila is like you know, I'm a pressure. I have to go through all of this. Well, how long is the pause? Kadehi lo dal damas, about 2 seconds. The amount of time it takes to take to walk 4 amas. He says whether you want to go step back and go back to your original place, or you step back and stay there, that doesn't matter. But there should be you finish off the first Shemoneh Esrei, pause briefly, and then you'd go on to your next Shemoneh Esrei. The next question which I have on my list is about using a knife sharpener for milchik and fleishik. Now, the Sefer Hagolas Kalim takes a view that you can use the same knife sharpener, but he does mention one of the Rishonim, a Yochid in the Rishonim, who does have a problem. And he suggests that perhaps in those times their knives were not so clean. If the knife has got no grease on the surface, it shouldn't be a problem to use the same one. Then I looked in the Sefer HaKashrus, which is quite a good Sefer, but he actually recommends not to use the same sharpener for both. So I'm sharing with you both sides of it. Especially the knife sharpener, does it become Yatzil Edes Beyator? Does it really become hot? So that's another reason why it shouldn't be a problem of using the same knife sharpener. But if one wants to be machmir, there is room to be machmir. Finally, we have our last question. As I said, we're going to finish a bit earlier because there's a chasna tonight in the community, Reis HaSimcha. So about a swing or a hammock suspended from a tree. Can it be used on Shabbos? So here you've got the two pictures. One is, as you can see on the left, this is the swing, which is hanging from a tree branch. And then we have on the right, we have the part of the hammock. One side of it is suspended from a tree, and the other side is actually to some kind of post, part of that framework of the swings. So this is the question: are you allowed to use this hammock or this swing on Shabbos? So there is a general principle on Shabbos, general halacha, that you're not allowed to use gidulei karka. You're not allowed to lean on a tree or use a tree to the point that if, let's say, you are in the garden and you want to take off your jacket and you want to hang it up, and there happens to be a cut off branch, and so there's like a hook sticking out of the tree, you're not allowed to put your coat on it. And if someone put your hat on that hook sticking out of the tree, you would have a problem to remove the hat. Or if a ball has sat on a branch, for you to remove the ball would be a problem of mishtamesh b'gidulei karka. That's how far it goes. That's if it's the tree itself. Then we've got tzidei ha'ilon, and then we've got tzidei tzdodin. One step removed and two steps removed. So let's read that halacha inside. This is in Simon Shin Lamed Vov, Sif Chof, and Alter Rebbe Shulchan Aruch. Also lishtamesh b'tzdodei ha'ilon. You're not allowed to use the sides of the tree. Avol tzidei tzdodin, but if it's two steps. Now, although we're using the word side, it can mean a step removed or two steps removed. If it's two steps removed, it's okay. Ketzat. How so? Sulam ha'somuch l'tzidei ha'ilon. A ladder which is leaning on the tree. Also la'al is be'b Shabbos. You wouldn't be allowed to ascend that ladder on Shabbos. Shaba'a li'yosi. As you are ascending the ladder, yumishtamish b'tzidei ha'ilon sh'somuch b'hem. You are using the side of the tree where you're leaning on. Avol im yesh yesed takua b'tzidei ha'ilon. Had there been a peg of sorts driven into the tree, you're allowed to support the ladder on that peg. It's two steps removed, you're allowed to. If you had a nail driven into a tree, that's sidodin. Then on this nail, this screw, v'tola b'kalkol, there's now a basket sitting on it, hanging from it. So the yes, it is called sedodin, and so you don't have to put the basket on or kalkol, the basket which is suspended from something else, is considered two steps removed, and therefore mutalitil chayvitz meha kalkol, you would be allowed to take something out of the basket. You wouldn't be allowed to remove the basket, so not put it in place. Because by removing the basket, you're kind of making use of that peg, which is the side of the tree, which is an extension of the tree. And then he says, if the basket is actually hanging from the tree itself, then the basket is studded, then you wouldn't be allowed to take something out of the basket. So coming back to our picture, so we've got, as you can see very well, you've got here to the side, we've got here a kind of belt of sorts, which is hanging from the branch. And then there is another contraption, and then there's another hook, and then you've got the swing hanging. So you've got several links in the chain away from the tree. And the same thing is, well, with the hammock. You got this black strip, and then that's from the tree, and then you got it's from to this is hooked the ring which is supporting the hammock. So in both of these cases, you definitely have a case of tzidei tzdodin, and therefore one would be allowed to use those the swing and the hammock, but that would be permitted to use on Shabbos. All right, I'm going to finish now. There's a couple of minutes early, but all right. I'll wish you a good Shabbos, and mentioned before. The names of the four people who are unaccounted for in this little building in Miami. I'll repeat the names for the people who came on later. Chaim ben Sara, Malko bas Sara Rochel, Yisrael Tzvi Yosef ben Toiba, Svido Neil ben Yehudis. We should hear Besuras Tevis and Yeshua Surafuas and Mashiach now. Call to other chance.
Good Shabbos.
Shabbos.
Masel Tov.